So I'm going to start off by reading the poem, an excerpt from the poem, How Good Afternoon Everyone. Isn't it a lovely state? Isn't this nice, the greenery at the back? So I'm going to start off by reading an excerpt from the poem that was shortlisted, the foreword. So basically, in the Caribbean, when someone dies, it's a big deal, it's a big kind of celebration, it's a big dramatic event. And when I call my mother or my family, they always say, oh, it was a good turnout, who wore what happened? And I was thinking, how would Lazarus fit into this? You know, after all this preparation has happened, what would happen if Lazarus came back in the midst of this? So this poem is about that, it's called Night Night. And this is just an excerpt. You can read it on the Forward website. The setting. If you did see people that first night, people for soul, who come from town, from far like St. David, from near like St. Mark to this little St. John parish, it had the makings of a good funeral. Pure bus park up by war roadside like ants. Their mourners arrived shuffling with the shock. The priest opened up that week with plenty of prayers. Corn soup bubbled in the iron pot. Red beans slowly converged with rice, thyme, and coconut milk. Chairs clustered like fowls in the yard. Till the mother fell down under the weight of her dead son. So young, she wanted. So young. So there's always someone at the funeral talking about the dream they had that prophesied the death. And Lazarus in the Bible had these two sisters, Martha and Mary. The dreams. Martha had dreams for souls since the night he died. And wise woman Clarice could not make head nor tail of flying fish and hummingbirds over rock river water, of eddies swelling on the rocky soil, of septic tank full of bleach and blue soap. What does it mean, she muttered. What does it mean? To hear his name called dry so on radio was the son of, brother of, left behind, broker up. And them dotish dogs howling a relentless dirge for their master who never held them with cake, who bought one fresh pot of dog food, chicken neck with gravy and white rice every morning like greeting. Them dogs howl so till grief lock off the windpipe. His resurrection. Well, when Lazarus passed up and stepped across the threshold of his own wake, rank with corpse stink, the wake broke up. Who put foot out of door quick time? Who start praying fast fast? Who failed and get revived with smelling sores? Miss Gibbs, forget she hits bad, till she take two steps and fall right up. And Mr. Power starts to moan about the good, good money he dashed away on pity funeral frock for Betty, and now she can't even use it. And Uncle Johnny starts flinging rum, shouting, "You're dead, man, you're dead!" Like libation have any power over the resurrection. Thank you. So when I was younger, we would shop in Brixton Market with my aunts. And shopping in Brixton Market for you as a teenager was traumatic. You had to pull the shopping trolley, which is the bag on wheels, right? And you also had to put up, and also you really wanted to be home because it was Saturday morning and there was exciting things for young people on television. But most importantly, my aunt and all of them would gather in this mind. They would stop suddenly and have long conversations while you're there thinking about what program you're missing. So I decided to write a poem about Brixton Market. And then I realized actually the thing that was really upsetting was the amount of time you had to wait. I would stand at market stalls and watch her take days to pick, or she would test the okra, bending their tits, and placing only the ones that snapped into a brown paper bag. And the way she scrutinized the yam, feeling and weighing it in her palm. Plantains picked one by one like an artist selecting her tools. Flawed produce would be haggled to the last, and sometimes she would turn her back and walk to make her point and get away. I pulled that shopping trolley into the stench of meat shops, waiting as she pointed to the slab she wanted. How many times would she point and wave to change her mind? I would stare at the goose from boiling chicken hanging from the ceiling, the cow foot and seven pigtails. I tried to hold my breath at the fish store as she chose the kippers, and we waited for the snapper to be cleaned. At Quick Save, each can of baked beans was vetted for dents, each egg delicately lifted and searched for cracks. I would learn that this is how my grandmother taught her, kneeling in the bush, uprooting dasheen on the family land. She too, hawk-eyed, tested each provision to know what was ripe, ready, and good to cook. Thank you. Buried it deep in the earth where you bury shit. She chucked it into a dark hole and shuffled dirt on top. Buried it with no wake, no funeral, no coffin, no fanfare. Buried it while it was raw, stink and bitter. It was early September. The phone rang, jerk out of sleep, fumble. The red sky of pre-dawn through my bare window. My cousin's Guyanese tones low whispering, voice broken, she sobs, till I too begin to cry. She stutters, stops, starts, tells me about an advert, a phone ride, a plane ride. They promised her work on a US visa. I'm a prisoner somewhere in the South. They take my passport, work us long hours, deduct our pay for food and board, then give us a trickle. I made more back home. We packed fruit all day. She left her girl child home in her mother's care and now can't send them any money. I can't see my way. Help me, she sobs. I make phone calls to older aunts in New York, not new to this, who tell me they will take care of it. A month later they call to say, we have her. How, I ask, but they have buried it too. We do not talk about those things. Raised in London soil and Guyana's sun, I never understood understood the need for cut as where it came from, till I visited Grenada, a place where man fists pound woman flesh like kneading hard dough. A sequel strength knock girls flat out when she mouthful of rum and carnival. Her runnel bust lashy woman arse every Friday and Saturday night, kicks you down, bust your tail, and next day is black eye and bruise as Pauline clings on to runnel's foot, saying she loved him through each blow, and I understand. I never knew I had it. I thought I was soft. Till that night, my friend could not drive, and I offered him my bed to sleep, and I felt something in his look, he and I alone in that room, and my blood raised up, my pores swelled. I went to the kitchen, took down that knife, marched upstairs and told him, I'm cutting it off if you lose your mind. Don't think it, and if you think it, don't sleep. This is my favorite poem. I'm just happy that I have a favorite poem that I wrote. There's no ego involved, it's just my favorite poem. It's called Fade. The museum is an empty house, a dead lifestyle. In the sitting room, pictures of Jesus spread on. An old rosary hanging over the bed. This is how we lived in the old days, they tell me. And I understand all the ones die, like you did, Auntie. The way your soul left your body blank on these sheets, the way these people left their home. I look at this old bed now. Did a mother die here, choking on her spit too? Is this her rosary? Did she lose it all? I visit the hospital a month before you die. Your left big toe is a black and cherry. Cut it, we beg, but our pleas are moot. You are Taurus, stoic, resolute. And that day you lost your rosary for 2 days. You search on the beds and in fruit bowls. You cry non-stop all night. Nurses sink mountains of soiled sheets until the rosary is found, nestled in your dirty pillowcase. And when they give it to you, your fingers continue rolling as if it had not strayed. And then you, who clutch your faith like a second skin, whisper to me, I have lost faith in my Lord. And I want to write a hymn for you, where voices lift and black choirs rock. I want to write a hymn for you, where sinners writhe weeping bitter tears. I want to write a hymn for you, where Baptist priests bring words of the congregation like fire, and Catholic priests throw holy water into the sky. I want to write a classic hymn, all harps and harmonicas, a hymn where our slave grandmas lift up their long frocks and trample the earth to sounds of tambourines. I want to write calypso hymns, folk hymns, reggae hymns, joyous hymns. I want to write sweet, sweet hymns just for you. My mother's blues. So my mother lives in the Caribbean, and we do the Caribbean and the United States, and so we communicate a lot by phone, and when she says certain things, they just kind of, they're like words in her head for days and weeks. So I'm going to say the things that my mother say, and you, who thought you were just going to sit in the audience, when I put my hand like this, you're going to say pain. You're going to be me, you're going to feel my pain when my mother says these things, right? So I'm just going to try that hand thing and see how you're doing.
Pain.
Great. My mother knows?
Pain.
A sorrowful gospel type of?
Pain.
A slowly losing our eyesight eye drops every night?
Pain.
A headache worrying for her children overseas, praying for their safety?
Pain.
A stare through each night, eyes black with hope they're alright? Yeah, my mother knows pain. It's my children don't call. Do they still love me?
Pain.
A worrisome dying gray hair, black children too far away.
Pain.
Oh, will my daughter ever have children? She's 38 now.
Pain.
Your womb is becoming stone, sermon for our only girl on her birthday.
Pain.
Yeah, my mother knows pain. So what did I do wrong with bringing them up?
Pain.
My son has gone astray. Someone put Obi on him, so I have to pray real hard.
Amen.
And look how so-and-so children do so well. I wish mine were like that.
Amen.
Yeah, my mother knows pain. Is the house now empty? No one to cook for.
Amen.
And I can't let go, and I have to let go.
Amen.
It's a let me tell you how to bury me.
Amen.
I want a plain box, no fancy coffin, or I'll come back and haunt you.
Amen.
I don't have no big set of people coming around calling it a wake. And let me tell you who will get what I've done wrong so you don't fight.
Amen.
And don't worry, I'll soon be dead and gone, and then you will miss me.
Amen.
Yeah, my mother knows me. Thank you very much.